modifying a 5-inch gauge Great Western Railway 14XX steam locomotive, Part 14, fitting the extension shafts to the injector water valves and painting the boiler backhead and ashpan. Please note, this is not a Kingscale or Silvercrest model locomotive. This engine was bought directly from the manufacturer in China. Injector water valves are normally a 90-degree turn on or off valve, and these valves fit under the footplate at each side through the holes that are finely drilled in the right place. And then they have a long extension handle to allow easy operation, and the extension handle just pushes into the top. So how do you fit these handles in place to rotate the valve? I suppose you could use Loctite 603 or any similar retainer, but then the shaft would never come out of the valve, which would make removing the valve, complete with the handle and the crossbar through the small hole in the footplate, quite difficult. So this is the way I normally do it. I've made quite a few locomotives and modified quite a few over the years, and I find this to be the best method. What I'm doing here is cross-drilling the valve all the way through the handle, and I'm going to fit a bolt in there. So in this clip, I'm at the drilling machine, drilling a hole all the way through the fitting, making sure that the handle is fully pushed into the fitting itself. I drill it first of all with a centre drill, followed by a twist drill. I'm going to fit an 8BA bolt through this hole, so I'm using a drill that is tapping size for 8BA. If you want to know about tapping sizes and general tolerances, there's lots of information online, or you can buy books full of information, so please don't ask me about it because it takes up too much time answering simple queries that can be easily Googled. I frequently get messages via email, and people are asking me questions all the time now. I have to say that I am not a free public information service, but I will always answer questions to my Patreon subscribers. If you help me, I will try to help you. So with the valve and levers drilled, tapping size for 8BA, it seems logical to use an 8BA tap to thread the hole. Be very careful with taps of this size, they break easily, and it's a good idea to use some lubricant. That way the tap cuts much more freely. There are many commercial tapping compounds available to make this job easier, but I tend to use my steam oil, machine oil, rapeseed oil mixture. Just take it easy, nice and slowly. Move the tap in about a turn and maybe back it out. If the tap feels like it's tightening in the hole, back it off, clean out the swarf and try again. You do need a delicate touch for this and a lot of practice. So if you're not sure, drill a hole in a piece of steel and practice on that first. And if when you've done that, the tap is still in one piece, then that's a good thing. It's worth mentioning that there are three types of tap. The first one is a taper, then the next one is a sort of second taper. It's tapered but not as much as the first one. And the third one is a plug tap for getting down into the bottom of holes. But for this job, because it's so small, I would generally use a taper tap. A plug tap would not be a good idea because it won't cut freely, it will clog up and snap off in the hole. So the secret to good tapping like this is take your time, make sure the tap enters the hole squarely, use some lubricant and be very gentle with it. And once the holes are threaded all the way through the valve collar and the shaft, you can just screw in an 8BA brass bolt. Make sure you use brass or stainless steel, don't use mild steel because that will go rusty. The footplate of a steam locomotive is, generally speaking, a very dirty and wet place. In this clip, I'm temporarily fitting the brass bolt into the other valve. These will have to be taken out to fit the valves and then put back in when you finally fit the water valves underneath the footplate. Now for something completely different, I need to paint the boiler backhead. And I'm going to paint the backhead to make it look more like a full-size locomotive. And I'm going to use this stuff. This is really excellent paint, HMG Black Satin. It really does stick to things. I got some on my hand at the steam workshop the day before yesterday and it's still there, even though I frequently wash my hands. Before I apply this excellent paint, I'm going to apply some of this excellent paint from the same company, HMG Paints Limited. This is Etch Primer. This etch primer has an acid in the paint that eats into the metal, that's the principle. But a word of caution, don't put it on too thick, because sometimes you can get bubbles in the paint that stop it from etching to the metal. I've been told this from a reliable source, it may not be 100% correct, but I always pass on information that I think could be useful. This etch primer and the satin black paint comes in an aerosol can. so it's thinned down to make it suitable for spraying, but it's still fairly thick. It coats very well indeed. The paint in some aerosol cans is very thin, and what I normally do is spray some paint into the cap of the aerosol can and then use it with a brush if I want to brush paint it. But some of the paint is so thin you have to leave it for about 20 minutes to allow some of the solvent to evaporate so that the paint gets thicker. These are the aerosol paints that I'm going to be using on this engine. The high temperature paint, and I'm going to use this on the ash pan and the fire hall door. Next to that is a can of high coat satin black. This is the paint that I used to repaint the footplate after I repaired the hole that I drilled in the wrong place. The HMG C71 Black Satin is an amazing paint. If you put one coat on, it's not quite satin, it's more matte. Coat it a second time and it starts to become more satin. This is easily the best paint I've used for steam locomotives as far as black paint is concerned. It really makes a miniature locomotive look more like a full-size one. The other can on the right is 1K Etch Primer. Again from HMG Paints, very good stuff. After the etch primer, I'm going to give the firehole door a coat of this stuff. This is high temperature black paint. I sprayed some into the plastic cap that sits on top of the aerosol, and this is what it looks like. It's very thin. But I gave the firehole door assembly a coat anyway. Then I went into the house to make a cup of tea, and when I came back, some of the solvent in the cap that was sat on the bench had evaporated and the paint was becoming thicker all the time. Really, to be perfectly honest, I don't need to use this on the firehole door. It is high temperature paint, but I'm only using this as an undercoat because I'm going to paint the entire backhead using the really good satin black. I can't sing the praises of this paint enough. It is beautiful to use, whether you spray it or paint it with a brush. And I hope that you will see the transformation from a copper backhead, which is not right at all in my opinion. Backheads of boilers were never made out of copper. The inner firebox was, but not the backhead. So I'm painting out some of the details that I don't like as well, which is this big hexagon in the middle. And it's not dry yet. You have to wait till it dries to see the full effect. So while the paint is drying, I'm going to remove the paint on the fittings because I don't want this horrible black paint on these fittings. Cellulose thinners or lacquer thinner will make short work of this paint and it will just fall off the fittings. So I put this on one side out of the workshop because it's very smelly stuff while the solvent removes the paint. The next thing to look at is the ash pan. This is made out of brass, which is not ideal for an ash pan, but we shall see whether it melts in service. I think it'll be okay. In this clip, at high speed, I'm using some Scotch-Brite to key the paint. Just clean up the brass to make a good key so the paint sticks to it. I'm going to spray this using some of the high-temperature paint, but first of all, I'm putting a very thin coat of etch primer on it. So this is a belt and braces approach. The high-temperature paint can normally be sprayed directly onto the metal, but I thought, no, I'll try and key it even better than that. So I finish off the job, and you can see it looks okay. The high temperature paint gives quite a good finish. All I need to do now is leave these parts for the paint to set. And while that's happening, I thought I'd just do this. These are the Chinese union connectors on the piping. This original copper piping is very thin walled and it's very badly bent. But I do need to use these Chinese fittings on some Chinese connectors. So that's it for this one. I can throw the pipe away, keep the union nuts and the connectors to silver solder to the new piping. That's it for now. Thanks for watching and I hope you found it useful.